do have quite a bit to cover, both in this chapter and in the next chapter where we're talking about antibiotics. And I think this chapter is fairly straightforward. This is where we're talking about physical and chemical ways of controlling bacteria. It's helpful to you, but it's pretty common sense stuff, most of it. So reviewing the PowerPoint, reviewing the book if you've got it, or a different book, or just reading your notes. And I've had so many people come to me and say, how do I study for your exam? Well, study what I've said in class. That's kind of what I've done. I've already watered it down a lot. You can read a book, and it doesn't have to be this particular book. They all pretty much say the same things. So if you don't have one, they've got a bunch of them in the library. You can go read them, these chapters. Don't study just the PowerPoint. The PowerPoints are outlines for me. They keep me on track so I don't get off on one of my tangents and start talking about some historical figure that really is not that important. They just kind of keep me on track. Review it, look at it, but I'd like to see some of you actually take notes in the class. I see a lot of you just sit there. It's like, it doesn't download into the brain that way. You've got to write the notes or rewrite the notes. So that's how you study for these exams. I don't give a study guide with exactly what's going to be on the test. I just don't do it. I want you to know this stuff because you're going to need it in nursing. Even some of the stuff that looks trivial may come back and come in handy. Excuse me. I'm hoping that all this rain will wash away some of the allergens out of the air and I'll be able to breathe again after this week. All right. Is this where we were? Somewhere around microbial death? Does that, any of that look familiar? This one? Okay. Well, we'll start with this one. Differentiation, agents versus process. Antiseptics are chemical agents when they're applied to the skin or to living tissues. They can help prevent vegetative pathogens. Vegetative. It's not going to stop spore formers. So that's always the bane of everybody's existence. Whether you're in food preparation or whether you're in nursing, those organisms that form spores are almost impossible to control completely, especially on the skin. There's no chemical that will kill a spore on the skin that won't also kill the skin that you're putting it on. So we're really just doing a disinfection when we put the antiseptic on the skin. A lot of doctors are still using hydrogen peroxide, and hydrogen peroxide works really well at killing a lot of vegetative cells. It's especially good at killing gram-positive cells, but there's some that are resistant to it, like Staphylococcus. Staph aureus produces a lot of catalase, which destroys the hydrogen peroxide. So that's why when you put hydrogen peroxide on a colony of Staph aureus, it bubbles and boils because of the catalase that's in there as it destroys the hydrogen peroxide. Probably the best thing you can do is wash your hands. Wash your hands frequently, often, and take at least 20 seconds when you're washing your hands. Like I say, I watch people in the men's bathroom at the sinks. I don't watch them anywhere else, but when they're at the sinks, I'm there washing my hands. This guy's already done, got the paper towel, and walking out. You got to give it time for the surfactant, especially with that cheap soap that they have in the bathrooms here, that powdered mess. I wet my hands and put it on there, and you can feel it begin to dissolve after a few seconds. But if you wash as quick as some of those guys going out of that bathroom, you're not doing anything but just kind of rinsing the outside edges. You got to get that surfactant underneath. So take your time washing your hands and do it frequently. It not only protects you, but it protects your patients. So do it often. If you come into my hospital room, I want to see that you've washed your hands. I'm counting down. I'm doing a little song in my head to make sure you do it enough. And so there's lots of antiseptic methods out there. The iodine scrubs, the main thing you want to do is make sure there's no particulate matter. If a person's going in for surgery, you've got to shave them because a lot of bacteria will stick to the hair around those areas. Anytime you have something break the skin, you have a chance of sepsis. If you have a fracture where the bone comes through the skin, they're really in danger of getting bacterial growth around that wound. If it doesn't break the skin, then the chances of it getting infected are much less. Okay. So now, stasis or static means to stand still. Basically, what we're doing with bacteriostatic drugs is we're holding them in place. It's not actively killing them, but it prevents them from growing at a fast pace. So if I'm infected with something in my lungs right now, instead of it being an allergy, and due to that infection, I'm going to get sick and die. I would prefer you be able to give me a drug that will just kill the bad stuff and get rid of it, but you know, if you don't have that, I'll take the static drugs to slow its growth down. That gives my body a little longer to try to prepare for an immune response to whatever that organism is. So we do have some chemicals that are called bacteriostatic. There's fungistatic. There's, I don't know of any virostatic drugs out there. But you know, they're a good alternative. I would prefer a cidal drug, and I would prefer one that targets a very narrow range of organisms. If I wanted to kill, let's say that there was a serial killer in the room, and I know it, I could shoot the serial killer in the head and solve the problem. But if I don't know who the serial killer is, I may have to just kill all the ones that look like the serial killer in here. Okay. All of those with blonde hair. Sorry. Blonde-haired people, you just die. I've killed some innocent bacteria in the process, but I've knocked out the one that's really bad. So if I know what it is and I can target it, I'm better off. I'm not killing all the good bacteria. But very few of the antibiotics work that way. They're going to kill at least a few innocent bystanders. Does application require sterilization or disinfection? Well, or is the disinfection adequate? If I'm injecting you or giving you something to swallow, I need to sterilize it. If I'm putting it on the outside edge, I don't want to give you a swab that's going to swab an area that's contaminated with bacteria. So I need to at least disinfect it, if not sterilize it before I give it to you. Most standards say sterilization. Can it, the item be reused, or is it going to be permanently discarded? All sorts of just common sense things. Like, can it withstand heat? If I bring some chemicals to a boil, it destroys their activity. So I may not be able to boil them. I may not be able to sterilize them with radiation or UV light because it destroys their activity. So then I go to something like filter sterilization, where I filter it through a membrane that pulls out all of the bacteria. It won't necessarily pull out viruses, but for the most part, when you're filtering medications like that, the only viruses that are making it through are bacteriophages, which are killing bacteria, not you anyway. In the case of chemicals, will it leave an undesirable residue? There's lots of chemicals out there. I could treat a staph infection. You can make 100% certain it kills. Of course, it'll leave a more scar right on your arm where I put the acid on there. It's just not a desirable effect. Will it penetrate far enough to kill whatever's there? All of these are things that you would have to think of if you're developing these chemicals. Alcohol works great at killing a lot of bacteria, but it evaporates so quick, the duration of time that it's exposed to the bacteria is love. So you might have to reapply over and over and over again to get the same killing effect as something that stays on the skin for a little bit longer. I'm not worried too much about this. Bacterial death is permanent termination of the organism's ability to grow, to be viable. And there's lots of ways you can do it. If you destroy all the proteins in the cell, the proteins are no longer functional. So if you autoclave them, that destroys the proteins. If you use chemicals to destroy the DNA, it can't replicate, that sort of thing. So there's a lot of death rates, and you'll see that it depends on all sorts of variables. How dense is the population of bacteria you're trying to kill? If there's a whole bunch of them there, it might take longer to kill them than it would if there's just a few. Let's see, how much concentration in an area can I, because if it's in a limited area, I can target that area with a drug, but if it's throughout the whole body, then I may have to keep the drug in for a longer period of time. Staph aureus has a tendency to hide out inside the body. They will cluster up, and they'll surround themselves with white blood cells, and they'll eat the white blood cells from inside out. Well, drugs don't penetrate that little walled-off area. So you've got to keep the drugs going for at least a couple of weeks, 10 days or so, in order to kill off all of the staph as they come out of those hiding spots. And they don't come out until they feel like they've got enough of a gang to cause you problems. So I'm hiding out in this place, and I replicate my clones until I got enough that I feel cocky. And I'm ready to come out and start kicking butt. So you've got to maintain levels of serum concentrations of whatever the drug is over a period of time. Number of microbes, the nature of the microbes, Mycobacterium tuberculosis is an organism that it's got waxy lipids in its membrane, so drugs don't penetrate it very quickly. And it grows very, very slowly. Most of the drugs and chemicals only affect those organisms that are actively taking up the drugs. So if it's not actively metabolizing, the drugs will have no effect on it. So it takes a really long time, months, in order to penetrate all of those bacterial cells with enough of the chemicals to kill them off. They have to be active in order to be killed. Does that make sense? Temperature, UV radiation, all of these things have characteristics that make them good at killing bacteria or not. Interfering organic matter. There's a lot of bacteria in fecal material, and a lot of those other organic molecules will bind to, let's say I pour some antibiotic directly on the smear of fecal matter right here. That antibiotic can't penetrate it, and a lot of those other organic molecules are going to bind to the antibiotic and prevent it from being effective against the bacteria they're living in. So if you've got a thick organic matter, it's going to be harder to treat it for the bacteria. Feces is known to inhibit a lot of chemicals. If I'm isolating DNA from feces, from fecal samples, it takes a lot longer to get the same amount of DNA. And I have to use things that will inactivate the organic matter in the fecal sample. I do a lot of gut microflora work, and it sounds horrible, but it's not that bad. But I do have to be careful when I'm isolating DNA from feces. All right, modes of actions of antimicrobial agents. This is pretty much exactly what you're going to hear in the antibiotic section. There's really only a few ways we can attack bacteria that are different than us. The cell wall. We don't produce peptidoglycan. They do. So a lot of chemicals can be used to attack the cell wall. If you can break that peptidoglycan, then the cell becomes susceptible.
the cell membrane. If you can disrupt it, soaps will frequently disrupt the membranes of bacteria, so hand soap works. If you can disrupt that cell membrane, then it's no longer active. All of those viruses that have an envelope around them, if you can lyse that membrane envelope from around the outside of them, they're no longer viable. HIV is one of those. HIV doesn't live very long outside of its host cell. So if there's blood, I lyse the blood with some chlorine bleach. They're popped. I wait a few seconds. I wear gloves. But once it's lysed that, they're dead. They're gone. So take care of the blood first, and then wearing gloves and being careful, wipe up the blood specimens. Synthetic processes. One of the first kind of antimicrobial chemicals out was a sulfur drug. Will prevent some cellular synthetic processes. It blocks some of the enzymes from functioning. And you would see some of those old black and white movies. A guy's got shot and he gets down in the hole. And he takes a packet of powder and spreads it over and he puts a bandage over it. He's putting sulfur on there. It stinks to high heaven. It burns a little bit. But by God, I'm not dying. You know, I'm putting it on there. And so that's what those sulfur drugs were doing. And then, of course, if we can attack the proteins. Now, we can't really attack the proteins inside your body very well, but we can attack the processes that make the proteins inside your body. For example, a tetracycline, which is an antibiotic that we're going to talk about in the next chapter, will prevent the ribosomes from coming together. So you don't get the translation of proteins properly made, which means that the number of proteins that are working in the cell go down the longer you're exposed to the tetracycline. Fortunately, they have a 70S ribosome where we have an 80S ribosome. Tetracycline won't affect us, but it does affect the... All right, cell wall. Cell membrane, cell synthesis, and proteins. A lot of chemicals, cell wall, detergents, alcohol disrupts that cell wall sometimes. It causes so much dehydration and it breaks some of the bonds. It blocks synthesis of new stuff. But alcohol, again, evaporates so quickly, it's not really good for long-term treatments. Cell membranes, detergents, soaps, work well in this category. We're going to get into some antibiotics in the next chapter that work. Cellular synthesis. Formaldehyde. Formaldehyde gets inside the cells and it's like hairspray. So if I'm putting formaldehyde on a surface, it's okay. But you can't put that on the skin because it will also get inside your cells and it... If I'm jumping inside your cytoplasm and I spray all that hairspray, you know, like my grandmother used to do, this cloud, and she had that big, she had the big hair for a while there. It freezes all the proteins so they can't function. So formaldehyde works on substrates, but it doesn't work well inside a human body. Radiation, same difference. I don't want to irradiate you because you're just a ethylene oxide is the chemical that they put that tent over that building in Washington, D.C. It was do you remember Tales from the Dark Side? It was an old TV series. It was kind of like, what's the other horror flick? I can't remember the names of them. But there was one episode where a family was having their house fumigated, and a killer trapped them inside the house and then was fumigating with ethylene oxide. So that would be horrible. It's like if somebody stuffed you in an autoclave and then you heard them turning it on. Can you imagine? That's a great horror scene. If I ever write a horror book, that's going to be a scene in there. Let's see. Proteins, really, heat, alcohol, phenolics, all those are great. They don't work very well on the patient, but they work well at cleaning up inanimate objects. So anything you can do to disrupt the membrane. I'm not going to go through that. You can look at those. Moist heat, hot boiling water is a good disinfectant. Every once in a while you'll hear of some city, they've had, like in New Orleans after Katrina, they had the boiling water requirement. Those are contagious. So if you got water out of the tap, you still had to boil it. The thing is no water treatment plant can handle infinite amounts of water. There's going to be overflow. So if there's a lot of rain in some of these cities, it overflows their system and you get contamination entering the way it works. So boiling water is great at eliminating a lot of microbial activity. Alexander the Great required all of his men to boil water before they drank it. So they stayed healthier, better than the people they were fighting. He also killed sick animals and put their guts into the streams and ran into the cities so that they were sick when they attacked. How do you know they're sick? The men on guard start pooping over the side and you can see it's diarrhea. So you could stand there and wait for the signs that the people on duty were sick. If you've got plenty of healthy people, the sick people are pulled off duty. So you wait a few days and you just watch for the... They had these overhangs where they'd stick their butts over and let fly. And, yeah, it's pretty nasty. Dry heat, open flame, moist heat, boiling. What happens when you boil it is it denatures the proteins. The proteins are folded into a specific three-dimensional structure or quaternary structure, and when the heat hits them, they unfold. And most proteins can't fold back into an operational form. So that's what the heat does. Dehydration, dry heat. So dry heat over a long period of time will work. Beef jerky. You think there's lots of protein and lots of food in beef jerky or turkey jerky or whatever it is. That dry process, dried fish, you keep moisture away and bacteria can't grow. They absolutely have to have moisture to be able to carry out any of their functions. So that's why so many cultures have drying effects. They used to dry a lot more fruits. I remember an old man had a station wagon and it was parked out beside his house in full sun, and he would line it with aluminum foil and peel his apples and cut them up and lay them in there with the windows just cracked. And you can just about see the steam coming out of it because he was drying his apples. He liked his fried apple pies. All of these are great for inanimate objects. And there's some times, but I'm not going to test you on exactly what temperature you have to. You do have to know the conditions of an autoclave. What are the conditions for minimum sterilization with an autoclave? Anybody know? 15 minutes is minimum. If you've got large volumes of something, go 20 minutes just to be safe. But 15 is minimum. What temperature? 121. What pressure? At least 15 pounds of pressure per square inch. So those are the conditions of an autoclave. If you're ever asked to run one, they've got readouts up there. You want to make sure that it reaches those levels and that time before you call something sterile. They have autoclave tape that changes color in there, but it'll change color even if it doesn't reach the right temperature or time. It just changes color when it gets hot. Spores versus vegetative cells. Spores have the greatest resistance. They offer the worst problems for us. Normally you have to autoclave or use a pressure cooker to kill.
kill the spores inside food samples. Home canned green beans are notorious for having spores get on them because dirt gets up on the green beans. And no matter how clean you are, they can get into your home canned green beans. If they're not autoclaved or pressure cooker is not working properly, then it doesn't work very well. I use a pressure cooker all the time at home because it cooks fast. You can put a frozen chicken in a pressure cooker and in 45 minutes that sucker's done. Okay, so I just like using them because of the speed and the convenience. But it does also kill the bacteria that could be in the cells. Vegetative cells are much easier to kill. Death times can vary from organism to organism. If you ever need to know, just Google it or look it up. You can figure out what time it's for. Most fungi, protozoa, worms are similar in their sensitivity to heat. They can't handle high temperatures at all. So most protozoa are destroyed by boiling. If you've got somebody that's got an enteric diarrhea, sending that diarrhea through a warming phase really works. They've got a lot of, you can buy manure from the co-op store. Now they have regulations on all that manure. It has to be heated to a certain temperature. If they're moving sand from the desert of near Nevada out to California for some of the beaches, they have to heat the sand to make sure they've killed any parasites that could be in there. Because they were killing sea lions by the hundreds by moving sand from Nevada out there. There was a fungus in it that was killing sea lions. So now they have greenhouses that they park the trucks in, and this truck has to stay there for a certain amount of time, and then they can move them out. Viruses are some of the hardiest underneath the endospores, of course. It takes 2 to 5 minutes at 55 degrees Celsius, 60 degrees Celsius for over 600 minutes. You're not going to have to calculate thermal dead time or thermal points. There are certain things like milk. If you boil milk, it separates. It starts getting, it doesn't have the same texture. It doesn't have the same taste. So people don't want boiled milk unless it's got chocolate in it. For the most part, we want our milk to be have that mouthfeel, that consistency. So Pasteur came up with a pasteurization method. And there are multiple different ways of doing it. But one of the methods is called the shock method, and that's what they use today in most of them. They put it into a tank, they raise it to a high temperature, and they hold it for about 15 or 20 seconds, and then they drop it. But the temperature is not high enough to boil. It just disinfects by killing most of the vegetative cells. So pasteurization is not sterilization. Milk still has bacteria in it. If you stick it in the refrigerator, and some of you bachelors have done that, and stayed there for a while, it will spoil over time. Especially if you're drinking out the lid, you're adding bacteria back into it. But some beers are pasteurized. Even though the alcohol comes into the beer, it's going to kill a lot of the yeast. It won't necessarily kill all of the bacteria. So some beer companies have a pasteurization process that they carry their beer through. Now, that will cause all of the CO2 to come out as it's being pasteurized, but they artificially put the CO2 back into it at the end of the process. And it's okay because they filter beer. If you make homebrew at home, it's got a lot of yeast in it. It's cloudier. It's not as clear and pretty as that stuff you buy in the bottle, see? But there's a lot of yeast in it. And I can't read all that. Here's a moist heat method. This is an autoclave. This is an old autoclave. That's one where you had to add water every time you did it. You used to have to distill the water, put the water into the machine, set it all up. I used to see these in tattoo parlors, but all of them have kind of gotten the newer ones where it's basically idiot-proof. You put it in there and press the button, and everything's automatic. A lot of the tattoo parlors are using those newer ones now.
You spent some good money going around and checking their autoclaves to make sure they were working.
But
the guys kept wanting to stick me on. I'll give you a free piercing. Like, hell you will.
No.
I was born with all the holes I'm supposed to have.
Dry heat methods. We've got a few of these in the lab. And hopefully, eventually, I'll be able to buy enough of them so we can get rid of the flakes.
I just am a little nervous with those Bunsen burners in the labs. Where these, you just flip the switch and it's electrical. It gets hot in there. You can sterilize your loops inside those areas. Plus, you don't have any aerosolization of anything that's on there. So, my dream is to be able to afford enough of those for all of you to have one each. Sometimes you have drying oven, hot temperatures that you can use. We sterilize glassware with those a lot because you can put aluminum foil over the cap, stick them in the drying oven, leave them in there for hours and or sometimes days, you never forget to go back and turn it off, and then pull them out and they're sterile. Cold doesn't work very well. I use negative 70, negative 80 degree freezers to store bacteria. Bacteria put in without, if I just take a colony and put it into a tube and stick it in the freezer, most of them will die because the ice crystals inside them will poke holes through the membranes and cause the eruption. But if I mix a little fat, a little sterile glycerin, in with the bacteria and shake them up so they're coated with this glycerol, it prevents the ice crystals from forming, and you can store them in the negative 80 for years. That's kind of one of the current methods for storing bacteria. Dehydrating bacteria doesn't always work. We do something called lyophilization. You ever heard that term? Lyophilized? Basically freeze-dried. So I take bacteria, stick it on a freeze dryer, it flash freezes it, and then it pulls the moisture out. Well, I can take that little pellet of bacteria and put it into a broth culture, and it starts growing again. So some of those bacteria are still alive even after freeze drying. They're tough little suckers. They're hard to deal with.
Most aren't affected by gradual cooling or long-term refrigeration or deep freezing. Temperatures from negative 70 to negative 135 can actually be used to preserve cultures. The CDC has multiple negative 70 degree freezers and they're all on different circuits so that they have duplicate copies of all the bacteria from this refrigerator in another freezer in another location. That way if power failure or something happened or the freezer just went out, they've got a duplicate. Alright, some bacteria are sacrificed. They like growing at the low temperatures of the refrigerator. So the pathogens able to survive for several months within a refrigerator can include Staphylococcus species, Clostridium, several Streptococcus species, that's why we pasteurize milk, that's one of the reasons. Salmonella, which is a fecal bacterium. And a lot of yeast, molds, and viruses. Your buttermilk will eventually go bad in the refrigerator. If you only make cornbread once in a while, you gotta use buttermilk to make cornbread. But you gotta check that buttermilk because it can go bad because of these organisms that are sacrophilic. Desiccation, I talked about lyophilization, gradually dehydrating. Neisseria gonorrhea, clap on, clap off, gonorrhea, not in a few hours of hot air drying. So they don't dehydrate very well. It's, a lot of your streps can't handle that. Endospores, you could keep them in arid conditions for hundreds of years. They've actually taken insects embedded in amber, drilled into the amber, to Jurassic Park, and pull out some of the gut contents from the bugs and able to get the spores to sporulate and grow. So they can withstand it. there's evidence that spores can withstand space. They've isolated them from the surface of the space shuttles while they were in outer space and gotten them to grow. So, you know, these are tough things. That's one way that the bacteria could be getting from one planet to another. You know, some asteroid hit Earth, it's going to throw a bunch of bacteria up into space. Most of them will die, but the spore formers might survive long enough to make it to another planet. Many viruses and fungi can also withstand long periods of desiccation. Lyophilization is the freeze drying. Radiation, we could use gamma, X-rays, or ultraviolet radiation. Gamma and X-rays have more penetration power. Gamma rays, shoot, they go through it thick. So they have these thick walled rooms that are lined with lead, and they can roll things like syringes or plastic bags into there, and they turn on the gamma ray generator. Don't worry, no Incredible Hulk will form from gamma radiation. It could kill you if you get too much of it, but they use the gamma rays to sterilize a lot of those things. X-rays, same thing. A lot of disposable scalpels and things like that are sterilized with X-rays. Ultraviolet radiation really just gets the surface area of stuff. I have seen a lot of meat markets nowadays are using UV. What they'll do is they'll wrap the meat and they'll run it through a UV thing. They package the meat, they run it through the UV, then they wrap the meat. So what happens is they've killed a lot of the bacteria on the surface of the meat, so it doesn't turn brown as quick. You don't get as much oxidation. So they do have these UV kind of things. It's like, I don't know, Burger King. They put the burger on it, and it comes out the other end, and then they wrap it. UV radiation is used a lot in water treatment and things like that. Well, that's something we can't read from here, but there's lots of ways you can do it. The way UV works is it causes thymine dimers to form. Basically, the UV light will bind to these two thymines, and it causes them to become bound in such a way that they can't function normally. Polymerases can't read that thymine dimer. So what will frequently happen is that has to be cut out of the DNA. Well, one thymine dimer probably will kill a thing. But a few hundred of those, and you start getting too many mutations building up. UV does cause mutations. Works the same way in skin. When I was growing up, tanning was the thing. I ran a grocery store, and these ladies would come in. I know the two sisters, and they were sun worshipers. They were out in the sun all the time. They were beautiful. I ran into one a few weeks ago, and she looked like she had cow skin. It looked like leather. It really had done that much damage to her skin. A little sunlight, okay. But the way they were doing it back in the 70s and 80s, it's doing too much damage to the skin. And, oh, God, Hawaii, I went to Waikiki Beach just to look, and I'm scarred for life. Some of those people, a woman in a bikini with that many wrinkles, just shouldn't be done. They make one pieces for a reason. It's a joke. All right. Filtration, 0.22 micron filters. Sometimes you can use charcoal. Diatomaceous earth is a really good filter. Unglazed porcelain can also be used. But they used to take, you know, when you boil an egg and you shell it, sometimes you see that skin on the outside edges of it. That's what they used to use as a filter to filter sterilize medications, because it has a pore size that is small enough to pull out all the bacteria. Excuse me. Now, they have 0.22 micron filters that we use for small volumes of stuff all the time. The pore size is going to filter out bacteria, but it's not going to filter out viruses. A condom has pores in it. Stuff can go through a condom. It's kind of scary. But the stuff that goes through, it's really small, And how do I say this?
Okay. The ejaculum has lots of cells in it. There's white blood cells, there's sperm cells, there's lots of thick stuff in there. It hits the walls where the pores are at, and even if there were free viruses, they're not going to be able to get through because there's too much crowding at the pore site. And if a HIV virus happens to be there, it's going to be dead before it can make it through the pore in the condom. So it does prevent a spread of HIV
as long as it remains intact.
One way the World Health Organization is trying to treat certain diseases, fiery serpent, Ranunculus metanensis, is a parasite, and it's gotten from drinking contaminated water. So they can take trash cans, put rocks in the bottom, a screen. They have a hole out this end that comes out, and then they gradually fill it up with sand. So now they go get a bucket of water, and they pour it in the top of this system. It filters through the sand, and the water comes out the other end. It's not sterile, but you've filtered out most of the parasites. So if you're out in the middle of New Guinea somewhere, and you don't have proper methods of treating the water, that is a quick and dirty way of getting at least a first filtration on the water. Then you recommend them boil it. But, of course, a lot of the natives in those areas have been drinking the water their whole lives. They think you're crazy when you tell them they've got to boil it first. But they will filter it because it pulls out a lot of the junk. Most of the filtration methods won't pull out toxins, so you can still membrane filtration. I don't know if I like that. See these tiny little holes here? That's bacteria. That's a staph right there. These little pores are the pores. They run in all different directions through here. And there's a lot of them are multiple layers of membranes that are laid on top of one another. So you've got pores that zigzag through that whole mess. And it really works well at pulling them out. You don't want to force them too much, but we have vacuum pump systems. I did water quality for a company down the road here. And we get samples once a month from them, and we run it through a membrane filter. And then we lay the filter. It was sterile to begin with. We lay it on a plate. And if any colonies grow, we know that their water was contaminated. They have to maintain super pure water. So that's why they pay JSU. It doesn't pay me anything, but it pays students. I have one student every year that goes out and does the water quality analysis. Osmotic pressure. Salt, sugar, causes a lot of osmotic stress on the bacteria. Salt cured ham. Salted fish. Salt cod. It's packed in salt, and that prevents bacteria from being able to grow on it. Smoking, so the actual smoke has toxins in it that kill bacteria. So smoking a lot of meats will also work, as well as drying it. They used to take and cut slivers of meat and then hang it in a smokehouse and then build a fire, and they would keep it smoking by pouring water or something on it to make it smoke. And the smoke would cure it, but it would also dry it out so you could preserve it for longer periods of time. Osmotic pressure is never sterilizing, but it is disinfecting. Chemical agents, aqueous solutions, chemicals dissolved in pure water, solvents, tinctures. Tinctures is an old term. You hear a lot of folk remedies and things. These are usually dissolved in pure alcohol or water alcohol mixtures. Thing is anybody in here like to cook? Got a few back there. You cook with wine? No? Yeah, start a little bit. I always cook with wine that I would consider drinking, so I cook with decent wines. But if you have a meat and you're trying to brown the meat and you pour a little bit of wine over it, it pulls out a different set of flavors than if you just put water on it. So using alcohol to dissolve out some of those flavors will give you a totally different effect. Plus the kind of acidity from the wine itself changes the flavor of the meat. But a lot of tinctures are alcohol-based. Old-timers used to take like yellow root. Yellow root's used for intestinal problems, and it would work to kill certain intestinal worms. Yellow root dissolved in water versus yellow root dissolved in alcohol gave two totally different effects. The one dissolved in alcohol would give you a much stronger effect in blood than the one that's dissolved in water. If you ever get a chance to go, where is it? It's Homestead Hollow. Anybody ever heard of that? They sell a lot of craft stuff that I consider dust collecting junk, but my wife likes that stuff. If it was me, I'd have a couch and that'd be about it. But, you know, she's got all this knick-knack stuff she likes. But they have an area up there where they talk about herbs and plants that were used. And they also talk about tinctures. There's nothing that's going to be perfect for every situation. Glutaraldehyde is pretty good at sanitizing, and it's cheap, and it's non-corrosive. It doesn't stain properties. The problem with glutaraldehyde is it can be mutagenic and toxic to the person. Hydrogen peroxide approaches this ideal, but it's got such a short half-life. Sunlight disrupts hydrogen peroxide. That's why you buy it in a brown bottle. Sunlight would cause it to dissipate, and it's not going to work properly. So there's not really a single chemical that's going to be perfect for every situation. And I just kind of rotate my crops of chemicals. I use pine salts for a while, chlorine bleaches for a while, and then I go to Lysols. So by rotating the crop, my bacteria don't know what I'm going to hit them with next. I may use one for several weeks or a month, and then I go buy something else. All right, this is common sense. Nature of the organism. Most of the time we don't know. It's junk on the surface of the toilet seat. So we want to clean as much of it off as we can. Flush it down the toilet. Nature of the material being treated, that you can kind of figure out. I don't want to put acid on the toilet seat, but I can use something like chlorine bleach or pine salts. The degree of contamination, somebody got sick and they threw up all over the toilet seat, that's a little more dangerous than someone who, some little boy peed on the side of the toilet and there's droplets on there. Urine's not got a whole lot of bacteria in it. They used to drink urine. Sorry, you can drink it. It's pretty sterile. That's how they diagnosed diabetes in the past, is the doctor would have to sip it. If it was sweet, he'd say, oh, you're diabetic. If you're trapped in the ocean, you drink your own urine. You don't want to drink that salt water. You go crazy. All right. Chemical strength or concentration. Can you dilute it? A lot of things require dilution. If you use 100% pure alcohol, that's not going to kill anything. You've got to have a little water in it. So about 70% alcohol is good for killing a lot of bacteria because the water acts as a carrier and the water goes into the cell carrying the alcohol with it. But 100% pure doesn't work. So the way you calculate the dilution factors is normally parts per million. And normally they'll come with recipes on the side. I doubt you'll ever have to calculate parts per million. Unless you go into toxicology, which is a really cool area. Length of exposure. Alcohol.
alcohol evaporates fast, so it doesn't have a long exposure time. Something with a little bit of oil in it will have a longer exposure time. A lot of cresols, pine sols, and things like that will stay in an area for a longer period of time. So even though they don't kill as quickly as the alcohol, they stay longer, so in the long run, they kill just as efficiently. Remember, clean off any large amounts of organic material, adequate cleaning. We're using a lot of disposable equipment in hospitals. Used to be doctors had one scalpel that was theirs and they used it all the time. Now they have disposable stuff that they use. There's even chemicals. All right. Biofilms are a problem. You know what biofilms are? Doctors are scared to death that bacteria are going to get in and start growing on the heart valve replacement or the hip replacement or something. So a group of physicians were diving off the coast of Australia and they noticed this coral reef that had no biofilm growing on it. Biofilm's everywhere in the ocean anyway. Some of the corals were completely clear of biofilm. So they went, ding, what's that mean? So they isolated a chemical from the corals, which was actually produced by a bacteria in the coral, and that chemical prevents biofilm formation. So now they're multi-billionaires because every scalpel and surgical instrument and anything that goes into the body that's artificial is coated with those chemicals, which I think is pretty cool. Concentrations and times and all of that, look it up. Most of the time in the lab, we use anywhere from 3 to 10% concentrations of the chemicals. And you can look it up for general use. Ethylene oxide, you basically have to fog the entire room and let it stay for a period of time. I think bleach is kind of a miracle of the world. It kills almost anything. It destroys viruses, bacteria, fungi, and most parasites. It is cheap. It's fairly easy to get your hands a hold to it. But it's not going to be very effective in bright sunlight or if you dilute it down too much. But it does work really well. So I do use bleach a lot. Sterilization, not sterilization, disinfection. Iodine's great on skin. They've done some chemical modifications to it. Oh, just had an itch. She had this look like she was in pain. Oh. All right, so you can go through and look through that, and there's all of them have their pluses and their minuses, but I'm not going to make you memorize these charts. Protein unfolding, once it's unfolded, it won't fold back together for the most part. There are a few proteins that can fold back, but not very often. Detergents can have charged head groups, and what they do is they get between the bacteria and the skin, and they kind of break the surfactant region, and they cause it to be washed away. Dyes are great because dyes have, they're salts. They have a positive and a negative end. And a lot of times they'll go into things like gram-positive bacteria and fungi, and the dyes will kill a lot. They used to use this blue dye that they put in the mouth of newborn babies if they had thrush. Thrush is a common yeast infection, Candida albicans. So they could use that. They used to give pills of crystal violet or methylene blue. There were rose Bengal blue or something. There were several of them that they would give pills for people with bladder infections because the dye would go through the system, the excreted and would kill the bacteria or the infection in the bladder. Now they have other chemicals that they use, but you know, if your were suddenly thrown back in time. Remember, methylene blue can work. Somebody told me about this. It's a series now. I think it's on Showtime or HBO. This nurse was thrown back into time in the Highlands of Scotland. And they said, you need to read it because they're talking about diseases all the time. It's a freaking romance. And I think her cure for everything was garlic. So I read about three chapters and then I kind of got sick of it. But, you know, it's... Imagine you're thrown back in time. What would you do to cure disease? Most of what you're going to do is this stuff. You're going to use sterilization and disinfection to cure disease today. Okay. Let's see. Limited applications. I can't remember the name of it, but they're actually doing a series about it. This is just repeating a lot of the same stuff over and over again. You're not going to have to be able to memorize this. It's just, that's ridiculous. They have different either detergent, halogen, phenolic compounds. They have a lot of different modes of action. And there are going to be protocols established in the hospitals that tell you what to use in what situation. So don't try to memorize all of those. That one's not my favorite lecture to give because it's not really that intuitive. I mean, it's more just rote memorization. You can read the chapter. Now, antimicrobial treatments is kind of cool when we start talking about antibiotics. All right, bright light for you guys in the front. So if you want an antibiotic, what are going to be the best qualities for a perfect antibiotic that you can think of? Give me some feedback here. I'm sorry? You want a broad spectrum? Yes. And no.
But if you know the bacteria, you won't want to kill that bacteria.
Right. So I want either a broad spectrum or a narrow spectrum. If you know what it is, using a narrow spectrum is better. If you use a broad spectrum, that's when you don't know what's causing the infection and you're just trying to... You're throwing a bomb down there to kill all the bad guys. What else? So the patient doesn't get killed by the treatment. Somebody over here, and then I'll get yours. Minimal side effects. Okay, so you, great minds work alike. Have y'all watched any of those commercials where they're doing drugs and then they list the side effects at the end of it? I'm like, damn, I'll keep the disease. I'm mad. Because really, it's the list goes on and on, you know. I'm not dealing with some of those side effects. What else?
Do you want
a
short treatment time?
That's very good, because the longer you expose someone to any chemical, the more your liver and kidneys have to work to remove that chemical from the body. And that's more harm in the long run. Anybody have toenail fungus? Well, you don't want to admit that. I do. And as a diabetic, I watch those toes a lot. I watch my feet a lot. The toenail fungus is hard to get rid of. And they have Lamisil pills that you can take, but they harm the liver. So I was debating, do I want to take them or do I not? And, you know, I'm like, sure, I got ugly toenails, but hell, I'm over 50 now, so it doesn't matter anyway. But finally, I decided that I needed to get rid of them to keep problems down with ingrown toenails. Well, it worked for a while, and now it's come back. So I'm just going to keep the ugly toenail and be careful. But short treatment time is a really good one. Anything else? Yes? Low interactions. I don't want to be taking a blood pressure pill and an antibiotic and then combined to kill me. I really don't want that happening. But now, kind of the hot topic in pharmaceuticals right now, pharmacists are using multiple drugs. So instead of giving you one antibiotic, they give you two or three antibiotics that are mixed together. Why? Because they're targeting. If I'm hitting you with a stick every day, first thing, your dad's going to beat me up. But, I'm hitting you with the same stick in the same place every day. Eventually, you're going to learn how to defeat me with that one attack. But if I'm attacking you, shooting you with a gun and an arrow and hitting you with a stick, it's less likely that you'll develop three mutations as a bacterium. I'm sorry, that's kind of a bad analogy, isn't it? I'm not that aggressive in real life, okay? I'm not. But the bacteria, by attacking it in three different directions, is less likely to develop any mutations. So that's actually one of the ones that I wanted to get to, and that's low resistance. So we don't want the bacteria being able to develop resistance against the antibiotic. Okay, what else? Let's just lump that in here with no harm, but you're absolutely right. So, anybody in here allergic to penicillin? Ooh, see, there's several of you. That's why they don't give penicillin that much anymore, that and the fact that most bacteria are becoming resistant to penicillin. And a lot of people have allergies to antibiotics. If you give an antibiotic, let's say you go wait on the doctor's office, you've got a kid, they're sick, you got to wait. I always try to pick out pediatricians that have a sick room and a healthy room, because there's nothing worse than going for a well visit and have to sit in the room with some coughing, snotty-nosed kid. You don't want your kid getting sick from it. So a lot of doctors are now doing the sick room and well room thing. But they give you the antibiotic after you've gone through all that waiting. And they'll say, well, the doctor wants to see you again, just a minute. The nurse will pop out, and you sit in there, and 15 minutes, and you're, damn, I got to go. I got things to do. Nurse will stick around. He got tied up. He'll be right with you. She'll run out again. All she's doing is checking to see if your kid's having an allergic reaction to the antibiotic. If she sticks her head in and the kid's flopping around on the floor, they do something. So after about 30 minutes, the doctor will stick his head in and say, I just wanted to make sure everything was all right, and he's gone. I mean, you made me wait 30 minutes. I'd rather they just tell me you've got to wait and make sure there's no allergic reaction. You know, but used to be they tried to snowball you into thinking that the doctor really wanted to see you. So you can't leave for 30 minutes. All right. What else? Y'all know I'm cheap. Cost. The cheaper, the better, in my opinion. Okay, what about if you're trying to help people in the middle of Africa and there's no electricity? You need something that is stable. The first penicillin G's to come out used to have to be kept refrigerated. If they got too warm, they were inactivated and they wouldn't work. So if the refrigerator went down in the middle of the night because of a power failure, you didn't know that the antibiotic wasn't working. And you really can't tie a refrigerator to the camel's back to go out and deliver drugs. So you want something that's really stable. I'm sorry? Yeah, you want it to be effective. You want it to either be broad spectrum or narrow spectrum, depending on your need. You don't want it to harm the host. You want it to have a long shelf life. Oh, short treatment time. Let's go back to that one for a second. That can also be a problem. Tetracycline, regular tetracycline, stays in the bloodstream for 12 to 18 hours before it's excreted. And it's very effective while it's there. The problem is getting the patients to take the drug every 12 hours. How many babies have been born because somebody forgot to take the pill on time? And, you know, that's getting people to take the drugs on time is kind of tough. So sometimes long serum, what's wrong? Spill serum. That's right.
Yeah.
I'm standing here looking at it, and it does not look right. Serum activity. All right. A long time in the blood serum. So they took chlorotetracycline, oxytetracycline, and they've added a chemical onto it, and it makes it stay in the bloodstream for a lot longer period of time. Okay. So now, that's pretty good. We'll get one or two more as we go through. Let's quickly look at modes of action. These are the way we're going to attack them. Modes of action of antibiotics fall into one of those main categories right there. So now, if I'm trying to attack proteins and I use just that antibiotic, eventually you're going to learn to avoid the stick. You're going to mutate, and you're going to be able to avoid it. But if I combine it with a membrane attacking, let's say, mixin B, polymixin B, along with the tetracycline, then what we get is called a synergistic effect. Polymixin B punches holes in the membrane, which allows the tetracycline to get into the cell to affect the ribosomes. So synergism is when the two work better than the sum of the two working separately. Mm-hmm. The two agents or whatever it is work better together more efficiently than the sum of the two working separately. So we're going out to cut trees. But you know, the guy comes and we cut trees, right? I cut trees that are about that big around the chainsaw. I'm too lazy to use an axe. So I'm giving you the axe. And I got a chainsaw. So you can cut down five big trees in a day with an axe. Trim them up and get them ready for firewood. penicillin resistance. So, you are a bacterial cell. You're sitting in the middle of the prairie, your little house on the prairie. Being attacked. Okay. I'm going to be as politically correct as possible. There are purple aliens with feathers in their hair, riding horses, shooting arrows at you, circling the house. That's politically correct. I'm not picking on purple aliens. The purple aliens are attacking the little house. How are you going to protect yourself? Form a coating, so I'd say a capsule. That does provide a little bit of resistance. The antibiotic can't make it through the biofilm, it can't get inside, and it slows it down. I'm sorry? Fight back. That's the first thing I do. I grab the gun. I'm a big believer in us keeping our rights to keep guns, because if somebody try to come in my house, they're going down. And I got two daughters, so all the little teenage boys out there need to know they better not try to sneak into my house, because they're going down. All right, so kill it. Penicillin's a great example. Penicillin's out there. It's coming into attack. They produce a chemical called penicillin ACE, which is an enzyme, and it goes out and it cuts penicillin right in its active site. So penicillin ACE is an enzyme that kills penicillin. Okay. Yes?
Call for help?
Well, that kind of goes under biofilms where they group together. Because if all of us are being attacked, I'm going to stand right in the middle and push y'all out to the front, right? Well, I want to live. Okay. So, there comes the shooter. Y'all get over there. He got to kill you before he gets to me. What happens with antibiotics is the chemicals absorbed by the ones on the outside edge of the biofilm. And the ones in the middle, by the time it gets to them, it may be in such low concentrations because else is already taking it up, the ones in the middle survive. So grouping together kind of fits into that category, but that's good. You ever see the Three Stooges? You ever see the Keystone Cops coming after them? What did the Three Stooges do to the Keystone Cops and if they were inside a house? Oh, yeah, they would change their appearance, so they would mutate the target. In that case, 70S ribosomes. Some 70S ribosomes have mutated so much that the drugs can't attach to those mutated 70S ribosomes. It's a problem, though, because 70S ribosomes were perfect in shape. Now they've had to mutate them, so they're not as efficient as the wild-type 70S ribosomes. So if this antibiotic-resistant bacteria gets out in the real world where no antibiotic is there, they're not able to compete with their wild cousins very well. But this is one way they do it. Keystone Cops used to come and they would run to burst the door down. One student would open the door, and one would open up the back door, and they would just run that Keystone Cop right out, throw him outside. They pumped them out faster than they could come in. So pumps. Pumps out antibiotic. They literally pump the antibiotic out faster than it can come in. everybody in here, most of you have cell phones. Most of you have had cell phones a lot longer than I have. Let's say that I come up with a drug that's going to attack your cell phone. Okay, I destroy your cell phone. If I destroy enough of the cell phones, you as an organism are dead. Most of you would die without your cell phones anyway. What are you going to do? Well, you protect yourself any way you can, but is there anything else you can do? Go get a new one, make more cell phones. So they upregulate production of the target. So if the antibiotic is binding to a ribosome, let's say the antibiotic is binding to the 30S subunit of the ribosome. I make more 30S subunits. Now, the antibiotic binds to 30S subunits, but I got plenty of extras. So you destroyed one cell phone. I got extras. I just opened the drawer and grabbed another. So I can keep functioning as long as I can outproduce the target protein and prevent the antibiotic from beginning. So it takes more and more of the antibiotic to get the same killing effect. Eventually, you'll overwhelm the ability of the organism to make new cell phones, but you may be to the toxic level by that point. So, you know, it's a problem there. So let's see. Kill it before it gets in. Produce a biofilm. Group up. Mutate the target. Mutate the 70S ribosome or whatever the target is. Pump the antibiotic out faster than it can build up inside it. So it's not killing anything inside the cytoplasm. I can upregulate the production of the targets. And some even, they take that to another level. They upregulate the target. They know that the 30S subunit is what the antibiotic is binding to. They secrete the extra 30S subunit out into the environment. So they use them as decoys. The antibiotic binds to those 30S subunits being secreted, and it prevents it from going into the cell at all. Because once they're locked together, it becomes an irreversible binding reaction. So now they've neutralized the antibiotic by secreting the target that they're going for. I call that, some of you probably watched Duck Dynasty, I've not, but they use decoys. They throw it out there for the ducks to be attracted to. If I throw out the subunits, then the antibiotics will be attracted to. So now, we've had the characteristics of a perfect antibiotic, the modes of action of antibiotics, and the ways that bacteria become resistant to antibiotics. So if I say, what are the modes of action? You've got to read that really carefully. Modes of actions of antibiotics against a bacteria. But if I say, modes at which the bacteria become resistant or produce antibiotic resistance, then it's this topic. You got to read the questions really, really carefully.
Good Lord. All right. Front light off.
Principles of antibiotic therapy. Modes of action of antibiotics against bacteria, and this is modes of resistance that bacteria have against antibiotics. I'll try to word it as clearly as I can and bold and underline the key words in those phrases, but every semester some student reads it and goes, oh, I know it, and they write down the wrong answer. So just make sure you read the question carefully, because I know they knew it, but the answer's wrong. I got to mark it wrong. So am I asking what are the modes of actions of the antibiotics against the bacteria? Or am I asking for the modes of resistance bacteria have against the antibiotics? Just make sure you're clear when you read those questions.
Alexander. The guy who discovered penicillin. I went blank. I'm sorry. Fleming. Alexander Fleming. Thank you. It happens the older you get, you start forgetting common things. I forget my name sometimes. But Sir Alexander Fleming was the man who discovered penicillin. There's an interesting story about him. He was the son of a poor, I guess you would call him a sharecropper. And his landlord's son was drowning in a lake. And I can't remember if it was him or his dad saved the little boy. Well, as a reward, the landlord sent Sir Alexander Fleming, who was just Alex at that point, to college. Along with his son. He paid for him to go for a big education, and he became a physician. So years later, he comes up with an antibiotic that later saved the lives of that boy's children. So after he isolated penicillin, the penicillin was administered to the next generation of that same family and saved the lives of two of his children. So, I mean, it's just kind of an interesting loop there. Sir Alexander Fleming was just lucky. He saw that this fungus killed the bacteria in a zone of clearing around it, and he recognized that. It wasn't until probably a decade or so after he found that first colony of fungus causing that zone of clearing that penicillin became available. He was already dead when penicillin was massively produced. It wasn't produced until the end of World War I, the beginning of, what's the next conflict? I can never remember, was it Korea or Vietnam? Which was next? One of those conflicts. I'm not a historian. People were dying of common diseases. Scarlet fever, staph infections, things like that were killing people like crazy. Word got out that the American government, the military, had penicillin. So people were writing to the President of the United States at the time, begging for single doses of penicillin for their children who were dying in hospitals. You can go back to some of those presidential libraries and read some of those letters, and they're heart-wrenching. They were scared to death that the recipe for penicillin would get out, because if the enemy got penicillin, they would have the same advantage we did. But they weren't the first to use it. Ancient Egyptians had rooms where they would grow bread mold. They would cut bread and sprinkle it with water, and then they would get penicillin to grow on it. And they had priests that would go in and remove any contaminated bread. It always had to be that, well, kind of like that green stuff that was growing up there. Didn't have that look, they pulled it out and got rid of it. They would use what they call bread poultices. So they would take that bread, they would mix it with some leaves of some plants that they knew were antibacterial with a little water and make mush out of it, and they would stick it on the wound of their soldiers. The Egyptian soldiers survived better than the other team. So they could recover from wounds that would cause infections and go back to battle more often than the other side. So their armies became pretty strong. Okay. I guess I better shut up with that story. I was going to finish chapter 10 today, and I just got started on it.